Welcome to our educational platform. This is your place to learn scientific biomechanics with a clinically useful approach. Today, we're going to talk about a very challenging situation. How to get a pure intrusion in a periodontally compromised dentition. This problem is quite common in adult patients, and the discussion about a mechanical solution for it constitutes a great opportunity to learn and practice some essential concepts in biomechanics. If you want to be updated in orthodontic biomechanics, don't forget to subscribe to our website, YouTube channel, and other social medias. But let's jump into our challenge. Our goal today is to learn how to intrude and retract the upper anterior teeth with a reduced periodontium. And here is the real clinical scenario. The patient's main complaint was the left lateral upper incisor. She said her tooth was disappearing behind the other teeth, which were moving forward and to the left, as you can see in this upper line deviation in relation to the facial midline. In fact, the patient's complaint is only one sign reflecting a much more complex case. Besides the significant bone loss due to a past periodontal disease, the patient also has tooth loss, a deep curve of spi, significant migration of upper teeth, and a dysfunctional occlusion, because both anterior and lateral guidance are not appropriate. Unfortunately, this situation tends to worsen over time, because the non-physiological distribution of occlusal forces, especially in a reduced periodontal, will favor the continuous migration of teeth. Two main changes occur in this case. First, the loss of marginal bone level displaces the center of resistance to a more apical region. And this increases the shearing force caused by occlusal loads dissipated into a more oblique alveolar wall, favoring the tipping and extrusion of this teeth. This case, in which malocclusions has developed or has worsened in adulthood, are called secondary malocclusions, according to Dr. Milsen. These cases are common in orthodontics, and the problem gets worse as the time goes on. Unfortunately, in several of these cases, the patient has not been appropriately diagnosed by the dentist, or he may have been misinformed about his problem. This can happen to anyone, even a president of a country. This misinformation occurred in the present case. The patient sought out several orthodontists, and they state that she would lose her teeth if she underwent orthodontic treatment. Come on, she will lose her teeth if she does not undergo orthodontic treatment. Yes, the orthodontic correction is needed in this interdisciplinary case. We don't need to achieve a perfect occlusion, but we need a functional one, in which the occlusal loadings will keep the teeth and bone in good physiological conditions. If you want to learn more about secondary malocclusions and how orthodontic treatment can benefit this case, we suggest the reading of our recent systematic review on this topic. And now that I hope you are convinced that this case needs an orthodontic correction, let's discuss the biomechanical details of how we are going to perform a true intrusion in this significant reduced periodontium. First of all, it's obvious that we will never apply an orthodontic force in a patient with active periodontal disease. This would be an iatrogenic orthodontics. The orthodontic treatment will begin only if periodontal tissues are healthy and if oral hygiene is maintained during the treatment. We need to constantly check if there are no bleedings or pockets of more than 3 mm probing depth. I mean, if you have a healthy periodontium, even a reduced one, we can move teeth. To understand some of the difficulties of this case, let's start by the differentiation between a real and a false or pseudo intrusion. A true intrusion means the apical movement of the CR of a tooth or group of teeth, as in our case. Remember that the CR is considered the heart of a tooth or group of teeth. in a sense that the resultant force system perceived by the CR will dictate the resultant tooth movement. In this picture A, you can see a true intrusion, in which the CR has moved upwards and following the long axis of the teeth. This intrusive translational movement occurs when the resultant force system passes through the CR. On the other hand, in this picture B, you can see what happens if an intrusive force is applied at the bracket level. Although the incisal edge and the bracket have moved upwards, the CR had not moved, because in this case the force applied distant to the CR will provoke a significant counterclockwise moment at this region. Therefore, in this picture, basically a tipping is being produced, which reduces the overbite but increases the overjet. This is called a pseudo-intrusion. This is the type of movement that we would achieve if you use a straight wire or a continuous intrusion arch in this case. And this is not our goal. In fact, in our case, things will be worse than in this picture. Remember that we are dealing with a reduced bone support, and these conditions provoke different tooth displacements and different load distributions when an orthodontic force is applied. Take a look at this experiment, for example. During my postdoc stage in Denmark, we have made a finite element study to analyze this difference. By simulating different degrees of bone loss, we have found that the same intrusion force applied to the bracket of a central incisor leads to different dental displacements when a normal bone condition is compared with a bone loss condition. The proclination in a moderate bone loss, for example, is around 3 times higher than in a normal condition. Not only the tooth movements are different, but also the strains induced in the periodontal ligament of this teeth. As more bone we lose, as higher are the strains in the periodontal ligament. These higher forces can be a problem for both the bone and roof resorption processes. To sum up, our results have claimed our attention that we need a very careful mechanics in order to work with compromised periodontal dentitions. So let's follow our 5 steps of a force-driven planning to solve our problem. And let's discuss some biomechanical details responsible for the success in the present case. As usual, in step 1, we identify the problem to be corrected, which is the extrusion and proclination of anterior teeth. And we draw the needed forces to achieve our final desired position. Considering that we need not only to intrude, but also to retract the anterior teeth, the desired line of action should pass slightly behind the CR of our active unit. I will not enter in all details of this case, but before performing this controlled intrusion, I have made a progressive slenderizing technique in the upper right side of the mouth. You can check the details of this procedure in chapter 18 of Dr. Milsen's book. In my case, a rigid TPA was used as anchorage, and I have uprighted the posterior teeth one by one until I have space to align the anterior region. This white wire you are seeing here is totally passive. When our individual distalization have reached the right canine, we are able to initiate the anterior alignment. After anterior alignment, a rigid anterior segment was installed, and now we can initiate the controlled intrusion and retraction. How can we apply a force behind the CR of active unit? By using a 3-piece base arch. If you are not familiar with this type of appliance, I recommend reading the papers of Dr. Burston. You can also check our video demonstrating the confection and activation of this appliance. Now in step 2, we will check the equilibrium of the force system we want to apply. In our case, the desired intrusive force that we will apply only in a single point will be accompanied by an extrusive force and a clockwise moment that will be perceived by our anchorage or reactive unit. In this case, considering the fragility of the patient's dentition, I will certainly opt to use an absolute anchorage. So, two mini implants were installed in the buccal region as the sources of anchorage. The step 3 is the choice of the appliance, a decision that we have already made according to our desired force system. In step 4, we will activate the appliance. The two main ways to perform the activations is by using bilateral tip-back springs or cantilevers. I prefer cantilevers because we can control the force direction by changing the angle of the ligature tie. Note that the angle of the ligature tie represents the direction of our force. Besides the force direction, there are more two force parameters you should control in order to get a physiological and effective tooth movement. After choosing the line of action of the force, you will check the magnitude of the force with a tensiometer. These are the recommended values for the 4 or 6 upper anterior teeth. It's very important to keep force values as low as possible. And finally, you need to control the constancy of the force. It's advisable to use an appliance with a low force deflection rate, which means that a low and constant force will work over a larger distance. This constancy is usually acquired by using cantilevers made from TMEA wires. The choice of the appliance also has an influence in the step 5, where you evaluate the need of reactivations. Considering the constancy of the system that I have just explained, the three-piece appliance usually requires small reactivations and longer intervals between appointments. In the present case, we have made only one or two reactivations during the 4 months the appliance had been in place. In the before and after comparisons, you can see the great changes induced by the orthodontic treatment. In the frontal view, the dental midline is coincident with facial midline. The crowding is solved. The patient is very happy because now she can see her lateral incisors. The deep bite was reduced and the functional guidance were re-established. The arch form was improved, and in the sagittal view, you can see the huge amount of real intrusion obtained. I didn't explain the lower arch changes, but basically the anterior teeth were intruded and proclined with a continuous intrusion arch. Of course, we didn't reach an ideal occlusion, but it is functional now. As a take-home message, I emphasize the need of controlling the force parameters, especially its line of action, whenever we want to perform a complex dental movement. Moreover, I hope the present case can be an example that orthodontic treatment is not a contraindication in the therapy of compromised periodontal patients. In fact, the orthodontic treatment in such case will enhance the chances of saving and restoring a deteriorated dentition. The aesthetic and functional results obtained have a great impact on patients' appearance and motivation. The repositioning of teeth can improve access for cleaning, re-establish incisal guidance, improves lip seal, and reduces the non-axial loadings, which can negatively affect the periodontal health. I hope you enjoyed this video. More challenges will come. Do not forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel, Instagram, and Facebook community. If you want a very detailed course with the main biological and mechanical concepts needed to master the segmented arch techniques, I invited you to enjoy our online course, available at the Udemy platform. It's a complete course, totally online. You can see the lectures at your own time, as many times you want. And your access is forever. This week, we are offering a great discount, only up to Friday night. So I hope you enjoy this opportunity to take your biomechanical knowledge and clinical practice to the next level. See you in the next videos.